Women of the Church and the Mighty Dillo family will be providing this year's program. Be a good voice, yes. Gifts and prizes are needed. The Church and Society Committee is in need of gifts and prizes to give the residents at Murray Hill Apartments when they have their monthly bingo parties and stuff. So if you are interested in giving to that, get a hold of Charlene Riley. She'll tell you what they need. Bottled water donations are still needed. The Evangelism Committee is collecting bottled water to distribute during the Relay for Life event as a gift of living water from the First United Methodist Church congregation. So please bring the cases of bottled water to the church so that they can be labeled prior to the event. Next Sunday is Pantry Sunday. They can collecting peanut butter and jelly for the Autobine food pantry. And then, of course, coming up is Cave Quest, which is the VBS on June 6th through 10th. So if you've got kids or grandkids interested in that, well, please sign them up. And I'm sure Damien will be getting in contact with the helpers and getting that all lined up. So, anything else?
Yes, Jim, I'd like to say thank you to everyone for the baked cookies, for the blood drive, participating in the blood drive, and most of all, using this wonderful facility that we have called the church for the blood drive. God was definitely there.
I agree. And importantly, thank the folks who were able to give blood. So, we've got some members of this church that are very dedicated to that and have given gallons over the years.
Even the pastor and her husband gave blood.
Even the pastor and her husband gave blood.
And she gave me fresh spinach out of her garden, so my iron level.
Yeah.
It didn't work out.
Any other announcements? If not, stand up and pass it.
Thank you. share in our call to worship. Great Spirit, come to us here and now.
Come with mighty power, come with awesome strength.
Great Spirit, come into our lives and come here between us.
Come so that we may energize and renew and transform in love.
Great Spirit, renew us and renew your church.
And may our celebration here together be a witness to all the world of God's continuing presence in our world.
Opening hymns.
Okay. Time for joys and concerns. Got to update you on Terry's dad. I'd asked last week to keep him in his your prayers since he was having a heart cath that Monday. They found out he's kind of like there's an old Indian cowboy at home that always just wore one spur. And being the curious kid I was, I asked him one time why. He said, "Well, he figures he's got one side of the horse going, but the other side had to follow." Well, Dad's heart's kind of been that way. He had a pacemaker, and he could work on one side of the heart and figured the other side would follow. Well, it ain't following right now, so they're going to have to update his pacemaker. But otherwise, he's doing good. The plumbing's good, so it was a big relief. So he just got an electrical problem with his heart, so I will get that taken care of. Is there any other joys and concerns? Needs to come for us today.
Terry Gathers went to the Needham Chicago ball game last night, and I guess he maybe had a heart attack. Anyway, he is in Wichita, and they're running tests, and that's all they know.
Okay. He carried Junior Burke. Anyone else?
My niece Terry Lynn Myers, that's how she goes, graduated with her Associate of Applied Science in Nursing this weekend. I'm very proud of her. She's a non-traditional student, 30 years old.
Cool. Who else?
Jason reminded me I didn't sneak in here early enough for announcements, but the Evangelism Committee, instead of having fun night on the lawn like we have in the past, we decided to transport it to another location to see if we could gather more people. And we're going to go to Highland Park on May the 25th, 6 to 8. Yard games and things out there by the park, as well as they also have the water park there at Highland Park. And then they have a place that we can right with the sidewalk chalk and different things like that. We will have hot dogs again, and hope you can come to enjoy that activity. One other thing from the Evangelism Committee, since I'm not going to be here next week, you're going to be out of town. We have been collecting water for the Relay for Life, which is 1 month from this weekend, 4 weeks. We are about 250 bottles short of what we had last year. And I know that last year they used every bit of the 775 bottles we had. So if anybody would be interested in bringing another case, it looks like we're about 12 cases short to reach that goal. Thank you.
All right. Anyone else back here? Everyone up here.
Brought up from the hospital in February after he had RSVs, When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, the sound of the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting.
Ils virent apparaître comme une sorte de feu qui se partageait en main et qui se posa sur chacun d'eux.
Y fueron todos llenos del Espíritu Santo y comenzaron a hablar en otras lenguas, según el Espíritu les daba que hablasen.
Τώρα όλος το κόσμος μένει στο Ιερουσαλήμ. Ο Χριστός φοβάται Ιβραίους, αλλά όλος το κόσμος ουρανός.
Когда сделался этот шум, и собрался народ, и пришел в смятение, ибо каждый слышал их, говорящих его наречием.
都惊讶稀奇说：“看哪，这时候话的不都是加利利人吗？”
Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues.
Sie entsetzten sich aber alle und wurden irre und sprachen einer zu dem anderen, was will das werden? Die anderen aber haben ihren Spott und sprechen, sie sind voll süßes Weins.
Our next hymn is number 393, Spirit of the Living God. Those who love me, those who knowing how is it that you were revealing yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus answered him, those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and he will come to them and make our home with them. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words, and the word that you hear is not mine, but is from the Father who sent me. I have said these things to you while I am still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not let them be afraid. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Almighty God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, Lord God, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. I invite you, if you want to turn in your Bibles to Acts 2, and you can kind of follow through. How many of you this morning during the reading of the video reading of the scripture could understand each and every word? To me, it is quite amazing that what took place so many years ago, when they received the Holy Spirit, the tongues of fire, they could understand each other. I know that sometimes, even today, we struggle amongst ourselves, even though we talk in English, we still can't understand each other. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Okay, so let's begin by looking at Acts 2, verses 1. I want to look for a moment at that word Pentecost. Why did God choose Pentecost Day for this to happen, for those who were gathered to receive the Holy Spirit? Well, I kind of believe that possibly there are two reasons. The first is it was a Jewish holiday. There was lots of pilgrims that day there. They were in Jerusalem from across the known world. Pentecost was known as one of three Jewish feast that would call all the pilgrims to come to the holy city. It's got its name, Pentecost. 50 is what it translates to. Pentecost equals 50th, from the fact that it took place 50 days after Passover. Secondly, it was a feast, the Feast of the Harvest. That is what it was called in Exodus 23, verse 16, and Deuteronomy chapter 16, verse 10. This Feast of Harvest can be kind of symbolized as wonderful language. It has much symbolic significance. The outpouring of the Holy Spirit and the extraordinary power was meant for the witness and for world evangelization. What is but a great harvest of people, a harvest of souls. 3,000 people were harvested that day and given over to eternal life with God, our Father. So, Pentecost helped bring about so many converts. Now look at verse 2, suddenly. I had to study this word for a little bit. Suddenly, a sound came from heaven. When I think of suddenly, I think of something happening very fast. You can't keep it from happening. I focus on this word because the Holy Spirit moves suddenly around us. You cannot keep it from happening. It happens as it chooses to happen. Just like you cannot keep a child from suddenly pouring or spilling their milk. say. You can't keep certain things from happening. So here the Holy Spirit comes suddenly. It comes fast. And it drives such a gallop. Suddenly. In the summer of 1871, two women that went to the church of the known Dwight L. Moody began to notice something about this pastor. You see, Dwight L. Moody at that time was serving a church, a congregation in Chicago. He was lacking in spirit. So these women began to pray for him every Sunday. They would gather in the very front row. And I guess back then, also the churches struggled with the majority of the people sitting in back. But they came and they gathered in the front row. And they, throughout the service, would have their heads bowed. And they would pray for him throughout the whole service. Dwight L. Moody felt a little bit of anger towards this. What are these women doing? So finally, he had enough. And one day after a church service, he went and asked them what they were doing because it distracted him. Well, they explained to him what they were doing. So he agreed from then on, weekly, they would get together and they would pray. Well, that church was taken in a fire not long after. So Dwight felt even more low. So he trekked his way to New York City, upon which he found himself on one certain day in the streets of New York City as he was going about and he found a congregation to give his message to. He writes in his diary, "What a day. I cannot describe it. I seldom refer to it. It is almost too sacred an experience to name. I can only say that God revealed himself to me. And I had such an experience of his love that I had to ask him to stay at hand. I went to preaching again. Suddenly my heart felt so warm. The sermons that I preached from that day on, they were not any different. I did not present any new truths, and yet hundreds of thousands were converted. I would not now be placed back where I was before that blessed experience. If I should give me all the world, it would be small dust in the balance." He prayed daily, and he waited. And when he fell at his lowest, the Spirit came. And it came suddenly upon him, and he was transformed, and he noticed the Spirit. It was a Pentecostal experience for him. It was not an experience of tongues. Instead, it was one of a harvest. A harvest of souls. You see, Pentecost can come to us in many ways. Some, yes, get the gift of tongues. They get transformed like that. But sometimes it happens quietly, and it's more inward transformation. And then sometimes it happens such that you begin to evangelize, and it transforms multiple people, if not hundreds or thousands, to God. And then the next verse, 2 and 3, suddenly a sound came from heaven like a rush of mighty wind, and it filled the house where they were sitting. And there appeared to them tongues of fire distributed and resting on each of them. Tongues of fire. At times, the Holy Spirit makes himself known through a visible outpouring of a manifestation. As such here, it was fire that rested on them. In the Old Testament, Testament, sometimes was a cloud, sometimes it was fire. But what we know is when the Holy Spirit comes, it is the presence of God. Sometimes it is invisible. We never know. When I received my calling into ministry, I was only in ninth grade. And at that time, I was a normal teenager that was going down the wrong road. My parents did the best thing for me and sent me to a Christian high school camp. And I remember meeting outside one evening, right before bed, as we were closing in worship. A storm was moving in, and it was at Camp Lakeside out by Scott City. And the Reverend Tammy Aubuchon was just telling us about her calling. At that time, I was just wondering if my life was meant for anything. And I remember praying with her, saying, God, please show me what you want for my life. And as we all grabbed hands in a circle around this beautiful cross, lightning encompassed the whole valley. At that time, I truly believe that was a visible signal from God that that was what I was called to do, to witness and to be a minister. My vision came with a visible sign. I have heard many others that it is internal, such as John Wesley, the founder of United Methodism. His brother, Charles Wesley, felt his heart strangely warmed, and it continued with him. He felt forever changed. He's written many of our hymns that we have in our hymnal today. John Wesley sought for that. He prayed for that, and it was not coming until finally in 1776, when he met out in Aldersgate. His heart was strangely warmed. He felt so transformed that he wrote in his diary that he will never go back. Well, sadly, the next morning he woke up and he wrote in his diary, oh, I so dream of that feeling again. He hit another low. Sometimes in each of our lives, we seek that feeling. We want the feeling of that warmth, of that fire to go through us. We want that daily, each and every day. We seek it. Sometimes we feel that it does not come. But as John Wesley did, as he did not stop seeking, he sought it each and every day of his life. And at times, he visibly saw the Spirit. At other times, he felt it deep within. What we are called to do is never to stop seeking it. We are to always go forth and pray. And when it happens to us, embrace that feeling. And then on days when we feel the furthest away, that's when we are to pray more. In Acts 2, when the disciples saw the tongues of fire and heard the violent wind, it was an overwhelming sense of the presence of God. It transformed them, and it happened suddenly. And what came out of that was an overflowing of worship and praise. They partied. They could not stop witnessing to one another. They could understand each other. As in verse 4 it says, they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. They began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. But they understood each other. They witnessed to each other. They were overwhelmed with the greatness of God. And that's what the essence of the greatness of God is it's overwhelming. When you feel that throughout you, you cannot stop witnessing You have to witness to the truths, to God. It's amazing. And it is wonderful. This is what I call revival. Back then, 3,000 were converted through the revival. There is a caution, though. Whenever revival comes, listen closely to this. Whenever revival comes, whenever the Holy Spirit is poured out in extraordinary power, division happens in the Christian community. Some genuinely inquire as to what this is and test all things and hold fast to what is good. Others stand outside and mock and write off the enthusiasm as merely human, such as they are filled with new wine. There were a division. There were people outside that said this is nonsense. All the people that were inside were transformed. This happens even today. And brothers, sisters, I want to take a moment to be extremely serious with you today. I have been watching closely what has been happening at General Conference. It will continue over the next week. They are trying to make some hard decisions. If the United Methodist Church can continue like it is, or if there's going to be a schism and if it's going to be divided. The church is trying to find a revival. We are trying to find a way to move forward, to incorporate as many as we can, but to also follow what it says in the scripture. And I am trying to look deep inside myself, and I question, can the church continue doing both, living inside the world while following the scripture? Or are we going to face a schism and be broken? We need to, as the body of Christ, live Pentecost daily. We need to seek the Holy Spirit as our guide. Because it is the Holy Spirit that will truly lead us. The Holy Spirit is that which we should be following in this time. Brothers and sisters in Christ, I have not been very proud of those who are at General Conference that are representing us. I am hearing that they are fighting, they are calling each other's names. They are actually even threatening bodily harm to each other. Let us not go where they are going. Instead, let us continue to be the body of Christ, strengthened here so that we can be witnesses and speak out amongst the United States and through the world that that is not how we are to interact with each other. And I pray for this church, for this community, that as we go forth from here, that people outside these walls are going to see the joy that we have in our hearts, the witnessing that we outpour, that they are going to say that they are filled with wine, but that they are going to want it and seek what we have here inside of us. And that a revival with the Holy Spirit can and will take place. Can I get it? Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Oh my God, we just pray that as we go forth from here this day, that we continue to celebrate you for the birth of your church and the outpouring of your Holy Spirit. May that Holy Spirit come and rest on each and every one of us and fill us with that Spirit, so that we may not be strayed by this world. Instead, that we may be transformed and be a transforming power for this world. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Page 881.